There we go, it's working now. Hello, Patrick. This is Edward J. Robin. That's how I go by. There's three names there in a row. Those are my given names. If you were to do a search, you'd find out there is no Edward J. Robin in the world. I'm the only fellow with that syntax of those three names. So I've chosen that as opposed to having that capitalized last name, owned my mammon. That family name was a slave name, and the slave owner, that was his name. And it certainly has nothing to do with biblical prescription, as you've observed. The men and women in the Bible did not have last names. So the personage, that word person being a mask worn by a player on a stage, is attached to us by the application of that family name. That is the bonded property. That is what is used for surety in the system that is put in place. There is no gold giving value to that money. Has not been since April of 1933. They bond men and women as surety for the paper securities that they make. And then they sell those paper securities, which are collecting annuities in Canada, were 12.3% per annum. You can read in Schedule 2 of the Canadian Ownership, Control, and Determination Act in the 1984 regulations. The 1982 Canadian Ownership, Control, and Determination Act is a rewrite of the Foreign Investment Act of 1933, which was written to allow the government to securitize men and women to have their flesh listed as surety. So that is what they did back in 1933. And 49 years later, Jubilee took place when they rewrote the Foreign Investment Act to make it the Canadian Ownership Control and Determination Act, and they did allow for a redemption clause in there to satisfy the Queen, which said that you must allow for a redemption. These people must be allowed their Leviticus chapter 25 and 26 redemption plan. So they are following the Bible. Your questions with regards to how do we work and not use the social insurance number, how do we work and get paid with no usury, no interest, no relativity to a bank. This is walking the path in Christ. It was never offered as a rose garden, and if it was, it was full of thorns, as well as the roses. So it makes it difficult. It certainly is not a simple path. One must ask for cash at the end of the day and be requesting that there is no bank account or checks offered. You do not run a bank account with checks. There is a bank account that can be opened where you are listed as the steward for the account. You absolutely do not own the money in that account, which is a repository, which is quite a bit different from a depository. I would rather be reposed than deposed, to give you an idea of the meaning of those words. So one can do that. One can approach the various employers and ask them if their understanding of their, or they have awareness of duty to accommodate and what that means with regards to legislation that has been established internationally. And the legislation has been written to include men and women, human rights legislation. I'm certain that I'm not a human, I'm a man. The designation between a human and a man is quite distinct in the fact that a human is somebody who has rejected Christ and figures they can get along fine without God. That's a human. So I don't fit in that category, but there are various legislations with regards to human rights also include men and women and persons as three distinct and separate entities. So it's interesting to review what is available with regards to duty to accommodate. And please research that. because if one does not educate the people that they may wish to work for or provide services for with regards to duty to accommodate, a lot of those people give the bums rush and say, we know we won't hire you. Up here in Canada, we have what is classified as a right to gain a livelihood. That means that you don't have to ask permission to go out there and work and survive. Everybody has a right to put a roof over their head and have a toilet, etc. So your right to gain a livelihood is not something you have to ask permission for. Now, when you need a social insurance number to get a job, well, that's asking permission to gain a livelihood. Well, that's an oxymoron. It doesn't take place. And that's why it's very important to distinguish the difference between you receiving an income and being employed as to you receiving an exchange of funds for services provided. There's a big difference in how you stipulate and how you designate what you're doing, services you may be providing, and what you're accepting in exchange. One must be diligent when one approaches being a follower of Christ, not to be assumed as bowing down to the codes, rules, and regulations of the Babylonian Talmud. As I see you've been doing your reading, you're probably one of the most articulate writers that have written to me, showing me that you have a vast degree of knowledge, that you've studied a Christian man named Dan, whom I know well. Dan and I speak quite a bit. I have great respect for Dan and him for myself. We're about the only two fellows in this neck of the woods, for that matter, maybe the world, that seem to have a grasp on what's going on relative to the fraud, the bonding at birth, and why it was done. Now, if you go to the Bible, Deuteronomy 1:17, Deuteronomy 10:17, 2 Samuel 14 and 14, Matthew 22:16, Acts 10:34, Romans 2:11, and James 2:9, you can see the only infallible, ironclad reason for not being a person. It is very important that you use those scriptures, because otherwise you will be defined as a lunatic and put up for a mental evaluation if you try to say you're not a person. By utilizing the scriptures in the King James Bible, nobody can disparage the scriptures for your reasoning for not showing respect to persons. It exonerates you and it gives you some clout with which to explain yourself. With regards to paying the taxes, any taxes that may be imposed upon you are immediately erased by Ezra chapter 7, verses 23 through 26, where the ministers of the house of God pay no tax. And the men and women today that would invoke taxes are certainly not godly. They are false gods. They've added to God's law. That Income Tax Act is not found in the Bible. And so you would have then Exodus 20, 3 through 5. Don't bow down to those false gods and don't serve them. Leviticus 18, 3 through 4. Don't walk in the ordinances of the heathen. Well, these are definitely ordinances written by men. They're trying to command you to do things. So Matthew 15, verse 9, Christ said, in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. So it's easy, and these are just a few, I'm just pulling a few up for you, to establish where you don't have to pay taxes. You don't have to submit to the codes, rules, and regulations of men. Numbers 15 and 15 makes it clear that God's law is for all nations. It's one law for everybody. So when we start to take our scriptures and we utilize them in a position that Christ told us to in Matthew 5:25, gaining an agreement with our adversary, exemplified by Matthew 18:15 through 20, we really begin to see the power of Christ's perfect suggestion of establishing an agreement, the opposite of an argument, putting ourselves into absolute honor, the opposite of dishonor by arguing. And it puts our adversary in a position as if you'd put love upon his head and he was feeling the hot coals. He cannot dispute the facts and the reality, and it's very similar to his process called notice to admit. In the civil laws around the world, the common law, the civil law recognizes notice to admit. And it's basically a tacit agreement. Once you get the facts in front of them, if they fail to dispute, they agree. So by utilizing your scriptural methods of communicating to these men and women working within the justice departments, within the taxation departments, with any commerce department of the government. Taking away their ability to assume anything about you is a job, but it is a very rewarding job when at the end of the day you have achieved success and they are warm to you and you have befriended the unrighteous mammon. So in that day when they should maybe be looking at you to try and squish you, they're going to say, oh no, I know that guy. He's okay. Just let him go. And that was the wisdom of make ye friends of the unrighteous mammon after we were told in Matthew 6:24, you cannot mix God and mammon. So you've got to choose whether you're going to be caught up with a usury interest-based blood-sucking vampire system, or you're going to be outside of that walking with Christ, providing services to people for fair exchange, every workman being worth his hire. So Patrick, I thank you very much for contacting me, and I thought I'd give you this short video to let you know that, yes, you're right, you must look for others to stand with and unite yourself with those men and women that understand that Yahushua, his Hebrew name, is the one to follow. And if you're going to walk with Yahushua under Yahuwah's watchful observation, then one must be very diligent in surrounding yourself with others that will have that same zeal, that same desire to extract themselves out of that old dirty whore called Babylon and come into God's kingdom, where other men and women recognize the freedom of following God's law and will show others and teach them that know it not. So I thank you again, Patrick, for contacting me. I know this may have not answered some of your questions, but I have to admit that was quite a long letter there with lots of questions. You're actively pursuing information, and all of it is found within the scriptures and a open-minded observation of what's taking place around you and how none of it is applicable nor can be forced upon you to intimidate you, nuisance you, or obstruct you in your ministry. God bless, Patrick. And I look forward to speaking to you, maybe on the telephone. If you can phone me, my area code is 780-616-6647. I don't know if I have calls from the United States. I know I have a Canada-wide plan. My Skype address is OWLMON1, the number one. That's my Skype handle, OWLMON, the number one, OWLMON1. I am owlmon@gmail.com, as you've already got my email address. I'm owlmon on YouTube. You've already seen some of my YouTubes. So I look forward to communicating to you again. You put great effort forth in your letter to me, and I appreciate that, and I thank you that you're one of the fold, and you've been washing yourself in the blood of Christ. There is more to come. Blessings, Patrick. Talk to you soon. Bye for now.